Hey, what's good, self-direct investors? I hope you're all doing great, and I want to welcome you back to my channel. If you're new here, my name is Jordan. I'm the mind behind Make More Capital, and today we're coming at you with This Week in Cannabis News from July 11th to the 17th. Now, before we jump in, if you enjoy this video or you learned something, please just leave a like on it as it really helps out my channel. And of course, if you want to learn how to take advantage of this generational investment opportunity, subscribe below so that you don't miss any future videos, while there's also plenty of content for you to go back, rewatch, and educate yourself with. I've tried to put all the news and facts in one place so that you can watch episodes over time to learn about the evolution of the industry, identify top companies that you keep seeing pop up, and take advantage whenever you feel ready if you wish to do so. And we're going to start with some good news that we got our backup plan finalized already, as Rep. Ed Perlmutter of Colorado tweets, the Safe Banking Act amendment was adopted to the full year 2023 National Defense Authorization Act. And final passage of the NDAA will take place later today. But keep in mind, this is for the House version only. And so we will have to go through the same thing as last year, where the House and the Senate will have to reconcile the bills and create a finalized one, which will either include the Safe Banking Act or it won't. And since Schumer, you know, did not keep his campaign promises and pulled it last year, we are optimistic that he might keep it in this year, because the problem only exacerbates the longer that he doesn't solve it. But we'll have to cross that bridge when we come to it. So just wanted to share this good news. And I do believe there was an amendment that also made it into the final version of the House NDAA that would streamline medical research for veterans. And so that's another big obstacle. Hopefully we can get out of the way, making it easier for veterans to get access to a safe and non-addictive alternative medicine. And so with that, we're going to have to wait until later on in the year to see if this actually means anything. But I think it's better to say that this is a plan B that's already in place if plan A, a safe plus legislation from now until then, does not work out. That's another way of looking at this. But again, based on what we've seen in the past, we do have to expect the worst. And so with that, though, just wanted to share that there is a lot of support. While it's not in Congress, in the Senate where it needs to be, there's still lots of support pushing to get safe passed, because it will make lives safer for Americans, it will solve a lot of domestic issues, and just to show major financial institutions push the House to approve cannabis banking and defense bill, the Safe Banking Act will help keep our communities safe. And so as we know, this did make it into the House version. Again, not the finalized version yet, that will come later on in the year, but just happy to report that Plan B is in place. And so with that, Fortune shares the story. Pot stocks soar after report reveals Senate Democrats plan to introduce a bill that would decriminalize cannabis. And so again, notice the choice of words that they're using, decriminalize. And so when they use this word, does that mean that they're finally going to deschedule cannabis at the federal level, making cannabis no longer illegal, solving a lot of domestic issues just like that? Or are they referring to medical cannabis only while leaving recreational cannabis illegal at the federal level? We don't know, but I think the sentiment change, at least from mainstream media outlets as well, is worth considering, as apparently a bill that would decriminalize cannabis at the federal level could be announced by Senate Democrats as early as next week. A source familiar with the matter told Bloomberg. And again, just the state of journalism is that when they're reporting on what could happen, as opposed to getting definitive news from, you know, politicians doing their jobs and then actually reporting on what is coming in the future. And so just wanted to share that from Fortune, as they claim pot stocks soar. While we're very happy to see that with the big bump that we did get on Thursday, you know, it's a little early to jump the gun saying that pot stocks are soaring right now. But with that, just wanted to share the same story from different sources if you wanted to try and get different perspective on the same thing. So this comes from Hempstaff tweeting a story from Bloomberg.com. And I actually don't have the subscription, so I can't actually feature the story, but same thing. Pockets Senate's attention in long shot decriminalization bill. Senate Democrats plan to introduce a bill to decriminalize cannabis at the federal level next week. And so again, a lot of talk just using this media buzzword to try and garner a lot of attention, but they don't actually tell us, they don't provide a lot of context saying what this is actually going to mean or how they're going to go about that. But regardless, hopefully we're going to get that news in time. And so this one comes from Nats Fertig, who writes for Politico as well. Senate Weed reports rumors update. Senate sources tell me that COA may drop as early as next week, but the time frame isn't set in stone yet. And we know that COA will be dead on arrival. So even if they want to introduce this, it's not going to have a chance. And then hopefully that is what's going to allow the rest, or the Senate Democrats, to pivot to a safe plus alternative before the election. Otherwise, they might just be trying to pandering to get votes. We don't know. But we just know that COA will be dead on arrival. And one source told me that it is definitively coming before August recess, however. And I believe that's before August 8th or 10th, around that time. And so that's at least 3 weeks from now until then, I think. So these are sources with close knowledge of the bill. Full story here from Political Pro. I think you do need to be a subscriber though, but these are the other sources that we have with the stories. So we're just gonna have to wait and see how things unfold over time. But with that, just wanted to share this one from Jungle Java, as a certified cannabis banker explains the Safe Banking Act's ripple effect. And again, just to remind you that the importance of safe passing or some sort of incremental step, which I'm optimistic that we're gonna get something. If we don't, again, that's possible. Plan for the worst, but this one comes from Gondrepreneur, and I just wanted to share this main snippet. So obviously you can grab the link below. I will put this article down there if you wanted to grab it, but we can't discuss the safe Safe Banking Act without acknowledging the ripple effects it will trigger for the entire industry and its partners. We predict these key movements in the field if cannabis banking reform is passed this year. And so with that, a bit more information from this article that you can pause to read if you'd like. But now onto some investment firms. Just wanted to share this one from Piper as it came earlier this week, July 14th. But basically what they were saying that they anticipated did end up happening. As Piper saying, Plan A won't have the votes. We expect SAFE to be added to the NDAA as a potential back. And that has been the case. Now, again, it does have to still go from the House into the final version when the House and the Senate reconcile their bill, usually later in the year, November and December. But still, just to highlight, as we've seen a lot of these analysts be wrong in the past, at least this time around, Piper does seem to be right. And they also add that CAOA is dead on arrival, legalization bill not going to clear the Senate. So you can pause to read for a bit more information on what Piper Sandler had to say. Well, we've got this one from Isaac Boltanski on U.S. cannabis. So thanks, Todd, for sharing this one, coming from BTIG, the investment firm as well. So do take these with a grain of salt and not completely at face value, as they relay Senate releasing dead on arrival cannabis bill dovetails with bullish view on cannabis banking passing this year. And so I'm just going to read this main highlight from our seat. The release of the CAOA is performative theater that should allow Senate Democrats to uniformly pivot to consideration of narrower measures, including cannabis banking legislation. We remain bullish on cannabis banking legislation during this Congress and continue to believe that the annual defense bill is the best legislative vehicle to carry the measure to the president's desk if we don't get that SAFE Plus from now until then. And so with that, at least Plan B is on the way. And so you can pause to read for a bit more information on what BTIG has to say about, you know, the next 6 months or the next 12 months, what we can expect. And the link is below if it's too small and you can't actually see it too clearly. And so with that, we move on to a few others from Dennis Rudev, basically highlighting again some of the same points just to try and give you as much information from as many sources as possible so you can make the best investment decisions. As Dennis Rudev shares, thank you, Dennis. Cannabis developments last week by Echelon. So the source here is Echelon. Strategic value in the sector is about to get started and to be captured and to be finally admitted by non-believers. It is fundamental, has explosive growth potential, all these hashtags. But nonetheless, just highlighting a few points that are worth noting that have happened in the past week. Senate Democrats expected to introduce federal cannabis decriminalization bill next week. And so this upcoming week will be a big one and we're going to be watching. House of Representatives approved cannabis amendments to the National Defense Authorization Act. Again, highlighting what we did just announce. Connecticut governor says adult use sales roughly 6 months away. And so hopefully Connecticut can get online and launch that adult use program before the end of 2022, which will again just help bottom line sales for MSOs in that state. Well, Pennsylvania cannabis banking and insurance bill signed into law. So we see the first state taking initiative since Congress and the Senate won't do their job. And are we going to see more states do this from now until then? We'll have to wait and see. But I think that's all positive. Well, Dennis shares another good one. Good summary of pot stocks. Share price returns over different periods of time. This source is Echelon as well. Well, these temporary share price returns have been extremely painful to look at, especially since the Dems promised us a lot and have not delivered on anything. It is important to remember that while these share prices have gone down, at least for the top five tier one US MSOs, their fundamentals for the most part, from my understanding, and likely yours based on a lot of what I've tried to show you, have only improved. A lot of them have only gotten bigger through mergers and acquisitions at like cheap costs right now that will give them a great return on investment down the line in the future. But at the same time, they've expanded by opening more stores and they've gotten into new states that might have been delayed, but we've seen New Jersey finally launch. We're going to see Connecticut and New York come online. New Jersey is going to be a big growth driver for the MSOs in that state, especially, but New York is what we're obviously waiting for to come online, hopefully by the end of this year or early 2023. But with that, just wanted to highlight that while the share prices have fallen, that is painful. As long as you can plan accordingly and you have enough cash to cover your expenses and you have an income that's coming in, there's no reason for you to need to sell these shares because these are solid companies. And at some point in the future, the fundamentals, the share price will reflect the true fundamentals of these companies and the growth that they're going to see in the coming months. Mark my words, I don't know when, but it will at some point. And so lastly, sharing this one from Dennis Rudev, as this is, I think, good news that we're not anticipating, but cannabis could potentially start pricing in German cannabis optionality for those with a footprint in Germany, mainly Tilray and Cureleaf as of right now. Nice piece by Cantor Fitzgerald. So again, take it with a grain of salt, not at face value, as it is from another investment firm. It could be speculation, but the sector shows, or is speculation, but the sector shows signs of recovery and potential growth in valuations. It could all happen really quick and fast. And so just wanted to share this one as well. Should cannabis stocks begin to price German optionality? Gonna leave this here if you want to pause to read, but definitely an interesting one to read through. And so with that, we've got a report from Benzinga, as apparently Q2 Canada recreational cannabis market analysis, 21% year-over-year growth outperforming the US. And so while this does sound good, I need to provide a bit of context that they don't provide here to help you understand why it looks as if the US is outperforming the US. why Canada is outperforming the U.S. And so there's no severe Croptober in Canada, from my understanding, or not as big of a Croptober operation that the U.S. has. And so we don't see the effect of that in Q4 and Q1 over the winter months that the U.S. sees. Plus, had New Jersey, New York, or Connecticut launched at the same time as Arizona, which would have been January 2021, this would have been a completely different story. But because of the delays, due to a lot of the incompetence from some of the regulators and some of the government boards, that did not happen. And so since New Jersey just got online April 2022, and Connecticut and New York are going to come online, that's why none of the growth has really been added to the bottom line for the U.S., but that growth is going to come. It just was delayed, you could possibly say, by design, but by a lot of factors. And so lastly, just wanted to say the reason why the growth is actually looking good in Canada is because Ontario, our most populated province, has now over 1,000 stores because they've been opening 120 stores a month for the last year. If you look at our second most populated province, Quebec, has 8 million people. They have like 50 stores. And so that's why they're not seeing the growth. So thank you, Ontario, for taking that initiative and at least making the Canadian market look good at this point in time. And so with that, in a recent analyst note, Cantor Fitzgerald's Pablo Zuanic gave an overview of the Canadian recreational cannabis market in the second quarter of 2022, according to data collected by Hifyre, a leading in-shop and online digital toolset for cannabis dispensaries. The Canadian recreational market continued to decelerate in Q2 2022 in terms of year-over-year trends, but it should be said that 21% year-over-year growth is much better than what we are seeing in the U.S. market. We estimate 1% year-over-year for Q2 2022. And again, so this is thanks to Ontario opening, you know, having over 1,000 stores opening and allowing for that growth in Canada. But at the same time, this comes from Croptober, you know, states delaying and not coming online like New Jersey and New York. And so when you consider that there's still 1% year over year for the fact that these new states with New York or New Jersey, 8 million people, New York, 20 million people, so like 30 million people coming online that did not come online, and Croptober, considering there's still 1% year over year and steady, I'd say that's quite impressive. So I think you need to factor in all that context. Zuanic does leave a lot of that out. And so adding, sales grew 8% quarter over quarter after a 2% sequential drop in the first quarter of 2022. But keep in mind, this is with Croptober and the delays from New York and New Jersey, which would have allowed possibly 20 million more American adults to get access to legal cannabis had they launched sooner than later. And so prices continue to decline and we see signs of stabilization, not letting you know that New Jersey just launched for adult use in April 21st of 2022. And so that's going to be a main growth driver until we see Connecticut and New York come online. And so Zuanic noted that companies gaining share tend to enjoy higher average prices and attributed this to more discerning consumers and companies realizing the race to the bottom is not sustainable. He highlighted that pre-rolls are the best performing product, but he again does not add that organically over time, as states reform their laws, the total addressable market is just going to continue to expand. And so with that, wanted to share this news from MJ Stock Trader as we move on to MSOs. Who gets the New York assets? I'm not sure, but the good news is Columbia Care obtains final order of the Supreme Court of British Columbia about their merger with Cresco. And so as previously announced, in certain states, namely Florida, Illinois, Maryland, Massachusetts, New York, and Ohio, Columbia Care and Cresco Labs will divest assets for regulatory approval prior to close. And so that means from now until the close, they're going to be divesting assets. How much money can they make back, especially with a New York license? 200 mil? Maybe 300 mil? Maybe 100 mil? I don't know. But there's a lot to look forward to, because while they paid $2 billion initially to get Columbia Care, they're going to make some money back from this divestiture, which is going to make the deal look even better. And we'll just have to see how things continue to unfold from now until then. But with that, Verano announces the opening of MUV Sebring, the company's 52nd Florida location. So good to see Verano continuing to expand in this very competitive state. If Sebring is located at this address, a busy thoroughfare with an average daily traffic count of 40,000 vehicles. So they imagine it's a busy intersection that would be able to help drive more foot traffic over time. While Verano's active operations span 13 states, comprised of 106 dispensaries and 13 cultivation and processing facilities with more than 1 million square feet of cultivation capacity. And so more information down here if you wanted to pause to read. But good job, Verano, continuing to expand. Well, we got news from Marijuana Moment that New York cannabis regulators approve rules to start accepting retailer applications from people harmed by the drug war. So good to see New York taking steps in the right direction to finally launch this adult use program after so long and so many delays. As New York cannabis regulators on Thursday approved rules that will set the state up to begin accepting cannabis retail applications from people disproportionately impacted by the drug war. Those applications could open up as soon as next month. That's great news, bringing the state one step closer to fulfilling its goal of launching sales this year. The Cannabis Control Board also signed off on a mock-up of the conditional adult-use retail license application, as well as revised regulations for the state's medical cannabis program. So Axel Barnaby, chief of state at the Office of Medical or at the Office of Cannabis Management, said that the recreational sales regulations that went before the board are really the cornerstone of OCM's seeding opportunity initiative, and it's truly exciting to see that initiative finally take shape. And so with that, in order to qualify for conditional adult-use retail license, applicants must have faced a conviction for a cannabis-related offense prior to the enactment of legalization in the state or have a direct relative with such a conviction, and they must also have experience operating a qualifying business. This is going to be a hard part because not everyone has experience operating a qualifying business, and it's not easy to operate a business. That's the hard part of operating a sustainable, profitable one over time. The definition of a qualifying justice-involved individual is also being expanded to include people who were arrested for cannabis but convicted of a lesser offense, which advocates view as a positive step that will broaden the applicant pool. And I would say that is true as well, but again, the hard part is having business experience or not to actually, you know, run the business sustainably over time. These regulations build on CCB's approval of numerous conditional cultivator applications, which are being granted to existing hemp businesses in the state, while Governor Kathy Hochul signed a bill to create the conditional cultivation licenses in February. And so at Thursday's meeting, members have approved an additional 20 cultivator applications, raising the total to 2023. And so the experiment that is underway in New York is continuing to take shape. And so that is good to see. We're just going to see, is it a good idea to just give licenses to people that, you know, might have had past arrests and don't have much business experience? Or is this going to prove, you know, detrimental in the long run? We don't know. We're going to have to wait and see. But again, just good to see that New York is getting the ball rolling. And so with that, we jump over to this one from Todd Harrison. So thanks, Todd. Sharing some big news out of Texas, a red state that has not been so cannabis friendly, as the Texas Agriculture Commissioner pens an editorial supporting the expansion of medical cannabis. And so I'll put the link to this description down below I'll put it in the description if you wanted to read it. But the Agricultural Commissioner wrote that it's time for Texas, even Texas. And so for the Ag Commissioner to acknowledge this is big, to enter a new chapter and a new attitude about the use of cannabis and its potential medical benefits. And I just wanted to add a few other quotes from here. So thank you, Nick Burwell, for just sharing this and making it easy. As I look back, and again, written by the Ag Commissioner, I believe that cannabis prohibition came from a place of fear, not from medical science or the analysis of social harm. Yes, more people are getting it. Sadly, the roots of this came from a history of racism, classism, and a large central government with an authoritarian desire to control others. Couldn't have been said better. It is anti-American in its origins, as could be imaginable. Totally agree. And so again, this is why we keep fighting, and sooner than later, we'll reach that tipping point where we get this plant back. It's descheduled, and it's back in the hands of the American people, hopefully. And so with that, the Office of Medical Cannabis Use reporting on the updates from Florida. And as we can see from this past week, dispensing locations that were approved by the department for the week of July 11th to the 15th, we can see many, as Move or Verano, as I did report, opened three new locations. So this would be their 50, 51, and 52 in Fort Myers, Sarasota, and Sebring. We've got Sanctuary Cannabis opening a new location in Boca Raton. While, as I reported earlier this week, Trulieve opening two new ones. I believe there is 117 and 118 in the state already, in Apopka and in Hollywood. Well, if we look at the qualified patient count for this past week, Florida increased their patient count to 737,461, an increase of 1,249 over last week. And so while the growth is slowing, keep in mind it's peak summer. People don't want to go to their doctors and get prescriptions. They want to enjoy themselves and enjoy summertime. And so with that, though, we scroll down to look at the dispensations for July 8th to the 14th, and we can see all the MSOs operating in the state, the number of dispensary locations that they have operating, and then the number of milligrams of THC sold this past week, the number in milligrams of CBD sold this past week, and the number of ounces of smokable flower sold this past week. And so while sales are strong across the board, it does look like some of these other MSOs are creeping up and stealing market share from Trulieve, as they have considerably less milligrams of THC and ounces compared to what we've seen in past weeks. Now, again, this does fluctuate, but just interesting to note that some of these others are trying to get some more market share, and it seems to be working as they're slowly but surely chipping away in this competitive state. So with that, wanted to share some global news. So thanks, Todd, for sharing this one. Apparently, European Parliament members are forming a cross-party group focused on cannabis reform. And so five members from different political groups, member states, come together to create an informal interest group that goes by human rights-based relating to the use of cannabis. And so just happy to report this. Well, it's still very early on. I'm not going to get into the whole story, but again, I'll leave it down there if you wanted to check it out. But still interesting to see that the sentiment is changing, especially from those in power in Europe that have the ability to make these decisions and make these changes and potentially reform their cannabis laws. And so with that, also happy to provide an update from Germany, as Alfredo Pasquale, one of our favorite European sources, shares breaking ministers competent in the fields of drug supplement supply and drug demand of the national governments of Germany, Luxembourg, and Malta met yesterday in Luxembourg to discuss cannabis for non-medical and non-scientific purposes. So again, doesn't really mean much now, but it is in line with the incremental steps Germany is taking to get this legislation done by the end of this year and to implement potentially an adult use recreational program in 2023. While he adds, they acknowledged in a joint statement that the status quo is not a tenable option. Yes. and that they want to facilitate further consultations regarding regulations of cannabis for non-medical and non-scientific uses. Good job. Thank you for sharing this, Alfredo, as Germany continues to make common sense steps in the right direction. And with that, wanted to share this interesting one from Malaysia. So thanks, Todd, for sharing this. Was not expecting it. Framework on medical cannabis products to be released this year. Kieri says the science-based CBD was compelling and hopes the government's policy will reflect that. And so there you have it. Malaysia, a very strict Muslim country as well, considering implementing CBD or medical cannabis because the data does not lie. And this is medicine. Time we acknowledge it. And so lastly, just wanted to share this interesting one from The Guardian. As regular cannabis use now more accepted by Australians than smoking tobacco, study finds. And so just happy to share that more and more countries are realizing that the status quo is outdated and does not apply and does not serve their citizens any longer. As regular cannabis use has become more accepted than smoking tobacco, the latest National Drug Strategy Household Survey has found. In 2019, data compiled by the Australian Institute of Health and Welfare and released on Friday asked around 20,000 people aged 14 and over about their attitudes towards drugs. It found, for the first time, 20% of respondents supported regular cannabis use compared to 15% in support of tobacco. And did they support alcohol? Did you even ask how they feel about alcohol, which is a drug as well and should be in the same category? They probably didn't, which is why it's not featured, but nonetheless, just happy cannabis is getting the recognition it deserves above alcohol, as well as cannabis became more widely acceptable. More Australians were in favor of greater penalties against tobacco use in line with falling rates of smokers nationally. So just wanted to share that as the sentiment seems to be changing and we're anticipating a possibly big week where we know that the bill, the CAOA bill, will be dead on arrival. We might get something introduced, which will again just create headlines and create more positive sentiment towards cannabis, something that we've been lacking for the last year and a half, but something that will return at some point. You best believe it. It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. But that is it for today's episode, folks. I want to thank you so much for tuning in, and I really hope you got some value out of it. What did you think of the stories mentioned? Let me know in the comments if you have any questions or suggestions, and I'd be happy to address them. But besides that, if you enjoyed this video or you learned something, please just leave a like on it. Subscribe below if you don't want to miss any future videos, and I'll catch you on Wednesday for Midweek Update. Have a great weekend, everybody.